my side, all done, all set. So I invite everyone to just relax till the end of the song and just ground ourselves and just let the beat take you and just arrive in your body.
Oh, thank you for the music.
like Steph is showing us, just let the music take you. Let your breath take you.
Where is your breath in this moment? I'm dropping down into my belly. I can feel that much of my breath is up in my chest because I'm excited.
And here we are. Welcome everyone. Welcome to a really fun interaction with one of my favorite human. We are here with Steph Magenta from Integrative Breathwork. Welcome, Steph.
Good morning, Alex. Likewise, it's always such a pleasure to talk to you. And, you know, what people don't realize is that often when we even start the conversation before we log in, I'm going, oh, we must mention that. Oh, we must talk about that. Oh, we must share that, because there's just so much to be shared around life and health and the breath.
And you know what? I don't know what's going on for you, but I'm in Paris, I'm in France. And what I'm getting all around me is people that are living in fear. They're living in fear. They are wondering about the future and whether it's related to the election in the US. You know, the king of the world is being elected at the moment. So the world is waiting for the new king to arrive. And then in France, another king coronavirus is taking over. So it's kind of, people are just sitting back waiting for something to happen. And it's really interesting because I don't know for you, but I think for most people, when something scary showed up, what do? We close it up. We just stop breathing. We hold our breath and we just wait for something to happen. And this is why this topic is so important, because we just know that we've got the tool or a magic tool to get us reclaim our body, reclaim our experience. It's just to reconnect with our breath in these moments where, you know, I'm in shock. I don't know what to do. And instead of trying to make sense of the situation, and, you know, good luck trying to make sense of what's going on around the world these days, there's one thing that you always have in your power is your breath. And if you are reconnecting to it at any given time, you can realize that right here, right now, I'm okay. Tomorrow, I don't know. But right now,
Yeah, because, well, there's several things you've mentioned there that already alight and ignite my response mechanism, which is that we are full of archetypes that we can make use of. So you talk about, you know, the king is about to be elected, and the king of the, you know, the people not knowing about the virus and everything. And that brings me into the question of where is our own sovereignty. And so when we use, you know, the king, the warrior, the magician, and all these kind of archetypes that we can play with and really tune into the energy and tune into the breath, and then we stay in present moment awareness all the time, because fear can't exist there. You know, it's okay to have the feeling, but we have to let it pass through us. And we have to be willing to just literally look for the teachings and sit in that space of not knowingness with the breath. And as you said, you know, the breath in anxiety or shock, we and it's gone. In depression and subjugation, and when we're feeling despondent, the breath becomes heavy and labored and shallow. And, you know, it's such a marker. I know I'm preaching to the converted here, by the way, but
oh, we never know. You know, we don't know who's out there listening to us. But let's start. You know, we're going to talk about the different breathing techniques and this controversial topic that we addressed the other day about which one is the best. Before we do that, let's introduce ourselves. So tell us a little bit about who you are and what it is that you offer, and I'll do the same, and then we'll dive right in.
Okay, thank you, Alex. Hey, everybody, good morning or good afternoon. I'm Steph, and I run a breathwork school called Integrative Breathwork, which I co-facilitate, co-teach with my very awesome friend and colleague, Dr. Ray Rydell. It's a 7-month online training, and I met Alex through, I can't even remember how I met you, but through these groups and through the breath, basically. And it's my favorite subject. You know, I've spent 2 or 3 decades working with health and well-being, immunity, what really helps us keep our systems clean, clear, bright, and energized. And now the breath is the final piece of that puzzle, which I work with, as you know, in quite a shamanic way. Mm. So, yeah, that's me.
And my name is Alex, and I lead teacher trainings called Breathing Cold, and I do it online and offline. It's a 6-week program. What's specific about it is I don't impose one practice, but I get everyone to be exposed to the magic of different practice, breathwork practices, with the intention of each participant to find their breath. And I think that's what we're going to talk about today, because we always come with the fact that there is one method that works, but you know, we are all individuals. And what I love about the breath for myself is it helped me find my identity, and I express myself through my different breathing techniques, and I change it all the time. And same with the ice. I love the ice, but I play with it and I change my relation to the ice and the way I approach the ice. So that's,
I would love to know more about that. Because you know, because I've only done an ice bath a couple of times, once with Wim Hof himself, and then obviously other times in cold water swims, or I think it was at one of Benedict's retreats, actually, when Anastasis came and did an ice bath, who's another Wim Hof trained person. But I'm curious to know, like, how, obviously I can imagine it does, but how your response to the ice and to cold changes.
Yeah. All right. This is not the topic, guys. So getting off topic right away, but that's us. You get to realize
We can come back.
But let's give it a go. I'll give you like a few pointers, and happy to elaborate at the end if we have more time. But normally the way I was taught, and the way, and again, also with Wim, and the way I was teaching it for 3 years to almost 3,000 people, was the idea of mind over body. I get in the ice, my body has a reaction, which is, oh my God, let's get the fuck out of here, you know, sympathetic activation. And through my mind, through my control of my breath, through my nose breathing, I calm down my nervous system, and I'm able to be extremely relaxed in a stressful environment. And for a long time, that's really why I love the breath. It was a way to rehearse stress. Now, all of a sudden, when stress comes in an uncontrolled way, I know what to do, because I trained every day by getting myself consciously in a stressful situation. So that's the way I've been doing it for a while. Oh, I think you've got echo now.
I have got echo, and I'm just going to stop that. Hold on. Bear with me. There we go.
Okay. It's really hard to listen to myself. Oh my God.
I know. I know. I'm sorry.
Now, listen up. This is how I go. I've evolved with the breath, and this is how I practiced it for a while, and I've changed it again. So here is how I went with one of my students, who was now a teacher, and we went for an ice bath. And usually when I'm with the students, I don't demonstrate. I hold the space and I do it, but I'm not getting myself. When I go in the ice by myself, I don't make it a show. And I went with her, we were going together, and she saw me get in the ice and start screaming my head off, and then crying, and then laughing. And she says, what? Come on, aren't you supposed to be the local Iceman? Aren't you supposed to control what's going on? It looks like a beginner. But my intention was to get out of the way. You know, we're so much in control of our lives all the time. And I love the idea that once I get in the ice, I'm no longer the boss. I'm no longer in control. I've got something that is stronger than me, that takes me, and I just surrender. And I let it out. And whatever needs to be expressed by the body, not by the mind, I let go of the mind, I shut it out, I get out of the way, and I let it out. And I, all of a sudden, it's a huge release experience for me. And whatever comes out needs to come out. Sometimes I have stress that needs to come out, and it comes into a form of screaming. And then sometimes it's happiness, and I start laughing hysterically. So, you know, it's the idea of for once, we're such controlled beings, getting out of the way.
Now, oh, that's so beautiful.
It's different, isn't it? You know, and if you think about the ice, what's going on in the ice? It's cold, it's bright, it's shocking, and you're usually quite close to being naked. it really mirrors what's going on when you come to life, when you enter this world. You come from this comfortable safety of the warm place in your mommy's belly. You come into the world, it's bright and people are screaming, it's loud. So basically through the ice bath, you have the possibility, an incredible opportunity to relieve some kind of traumas. And often the biggest trauma is the trauma of your birth. And having to do that consciously, I can always get out. I'm in control. But I choose to stay in the discomfort of the ice and to go with it, go with whatever, not trying to hold back and scream and hate it and love it and whatever emotions are coming up is a really incredible experience. And it's so ready available. You know, you need a cold shower. You know, it's that's what's magical about the ice. Now, lately, I've changed again, and I'm actually putting some really nice music, fun music, and I'm dancing. And now I'm dancing in the shower and I'm playing, and I can spend 10 minutes in a cold shower and I'm doing the most incredible choreography in my shower, you know? So I'm having a lot of fun. And something that I don't know for you, but I find that if you ask me what I miss the most, is a good old fun. I find that Everything is heavy and serious and daunting, and almost, you know, when you start to be happy, people say, you should be ashamed to be happy. Come on, look at the world. People are dying in hospitals and it's a misery and da-da-da-da-da. And you're happy and you're dancing? Oh, come on. So I feel that just allowing myself to be in a place where fuck everything, fuck everyone, I'm happy and I'm letting it out, it feels really good. So, and my point here with all that is, don't follow any guidelines or any rules, and don't try to do things in a certain way, but just get out of your own way. Stop listening to me or anyone, but just allow the body to whoo, let it out. So that's my two cents on the ice bath.
And that leads us beautifully into when you follow that flow and you let go of control and you get let go of form and structure and rules, you know, what the reason we came together, Alex, and for anybody who's watching to have this talk is because, you know, I run a breathwork community. I've got my page. Alex has got his page. We have our experience of the breath. And I started to notice that there's quite a lot of kind of like just implicit criticism in other people's breathing techniques, sometimes explicit criticism and sometimes implied criticism in the way that we write our copy and that we market our trainings or our events. And I thought, well, this is really interesting because it's like, shouldn't breathe that way. Oh, no, you're doing yourself wrong if you do that practice, or this one's the right way, or that one's for hippies and that one's all love and light, and that one's like, you know, you're going to damage your critical thinking ability if you keep breathing in that way. You shouldn't breathe with your mouth open. You should breathe with your mouth open. You shouldn't breathe only through the nose permanently. Oh yes, you should. And you know, this is good and that's bad. And I was just like, wow, you know, like you, even my own practice has evolved, because if I stay in presence, it's a law of nature, it's a universal law that everything changes, everything moves. The world wants movement. And when we become static, I feel that that's where the problems start to arise, because we become attached to a point of view or a perspective or a practice. And actually, you know, all of these things are practices that we put in place that are there to teach us how to be a better human being, you know, to be healthy, to be whole. And what is it to be whole? To have a holistic approach to life. We can engage so many different techniques. We can be inspired by so many different people. And so I want to move away. Amen.
Amen to that. But you know, let's dive into it, because not everyone is an advanced breath worker who's watching. I think it would be interesting to let's dive into the different breathing techniques with the plus and the minus, or what's known in the science. Because, you know, to be honest, I don't know, from my perspective, I feel that the placebo effect has the biggest impact of all. So as long as I tell you something and you believe it, it's going to have an effect. And if I tell you this is the effect that you're going to get, you're going to get it. And almost regardless of the technique that I use, it's the ability for you to surrender and to say, oh my God, yes, this makes sense. I'm going to go with it. And then allowing yourself to feel. Once you believe it, you're feeling it. And, you know, there are plenty of studies like that. If I tell you you're going to die in 1 year, in exactly 1 year, and you believe it, in exactly 1 year, you will die. And if you believe, if I tell you you are healthy, you don't have a cancer, you're safe, you will heal from your cancer. So the don't underestimate the power of your belief. And as long as you put the right set of belief in your brain and you upload them and you believe them and you sit with them, they will have a tremendous impact, whatever you want to use it. So it's an incredible power you've got there. Very important to say, because then we can always have those tiny little debates on nose breathing versus mouth breathing. And we're going to dive into it because I think it's important to know the differences. And there are physiological differences. But beyond that, I feel that I can take anyone, I experience it, and I really tell them the opposite of what I've learned from the teaching, and they have an incredible experience as well, which is not the one that they're supposed to have if I stick to the practice that they have. So yeah, it is a part of a placebo in all these things as well. So let's dive into it.
I would agree with that.
Let's dive into it. So let's tell, because you have a specific technique, the shamanic breathwork you touch. Tell us about the one that you apply, that you use the most, and tell us why.
Okay. I don't even call it shamanic breathwork. You know, I've moved away from many labels. I work in a shamanic way because that's part of my life path, which is all about learning to live in the present moment, learning to live in the heart, coming into the heart all the time, and sensing and feeling everything through the body. So I was trained in conscious connected breathwork. And that is the foundation of what we train our students in. But as my personal practice has evolved to encounter all these different types of breath work, I have started integrating aspects of breath retention. I've started integrating aspects of movement, conscious, intentional movement, and aspects of sound and sounding. But never to get stuck, because it's the attachment to the process. You know, what you said before interests me about the placebo and tell people they're going to have this experience, because there's also what I call and commonly and often refer to the intelligence of the breath. And so regardless of what you and I say and do, the body and the breath have a wisdom that when we start to breathe and increase our attention to the breath, to the body, maybe that's all that we're doing, increasing our attention, but we're also affecting physiological and hormonal changes, then things start to move in us, those things that we have held in control and kind of locked in tightly. So, but I found that if I just said, okay, everybody, we're going to do open mouth breathing for an hour, and you know, you're kind of lying down and we're then some people experience the sensitivity to the physical symptoms, which can be affected by diet and nutrition and where you are in your cycle of the month for women, and think everything affects us, everything, you know, we're interrelated beings. And so I noticed that if I just stuck with that way, that people then would drop into habits. So for example, every breathe there would be a drama, or every breathe there would be a feeling that came up and that never really moved, a bit like I've seen in plant medicine ceremonies where people go with the same issues and they go and do the practice or the process, but they get so attached and stuck in the loop of the story that they can't get out. So I thought, okay, what do I want to bring in? Let's bring in some awareness of breath retention, because when we hold our breath and there's no breath, to just sense what the body is doing without breathing, but it's still moving and it's still this absolute kind of ecosystem in the body, is phenomenal to me. And then to bring in some movement and then stop and feel, has that changed my energy? Has that changed, you know, change body, change mind. So my technique is a combination of all of those things, but I train my students with the foundations to conscious connected breath work. I don't bring in all of that stuff as we're training them, because I think that the important thing, maybe you disagree, maybe you agree, but for me, the important thing is to understand a practice or technique really well before we start to deviate and find our own relationship with it. And I suspect that that's what you've done on your journey.
Yes, for sure. And we definitely dive into the understanding of I teach one specific technique that I love, and getting people to master it. and then after that evolve. Before I respond, there is one thing that I want to point out that I think is absolutely fundamental in your sharing, is you said at one stage when we are focusing on the breath, and all of a sudden we are narrowing our focus and focusing on the breath. And I absolutely love that. I call it forced mindfulness. I think breath work is meditation for beginners. You know, it's very hard to just stay with the breath. And when you are focusing on a breathing pattern and you've got someone just guiding you, whatever that is, whether it's a retention or it's or not, you are narrowing your focus. And it's exactly what we are trying to achieve, is all of a sudden we slow down the brain waves and we are entering in a state where we alter the consciousness. We are getting out of the beta where it's always, okay, am I alive? How am I safe? Am I alive? What's going on? What do I need to do? And we are able to get out of that, feel safe, feel in our body, and the breath is a shortcut. And I think it's really an important element to really get people, because people sometimes they do the technique, but they do something else at the same time. They will not be focused. So it's really important to really create the container when you do the breath work. So you allow yourself to go dive in and dive within. And if you do that, then you will go to places. And as you said, you get out of the way, you don't know where you're going to go, but you're allowing yourself the space and the time to go somewhere.
And which is also where the fear can arise, and then the contraction happens, because suddenly people will be like, oh, something's happening. Or a memory, a feeling takes over, and we're so afraid to express anger, afraid to express grief. You know, I just spent the weekend working with conscious dying, grieving, death, burial, longing, loss, and all those things, because we were on our shamanic training on that part of our work. And we just don't have these rites of passage for any of that stuff. We don't know. We don't have rites of passage where we can find our anger, we can find our edges, initiation ceremonies. And so we go looking for that by seeking thrills or seeking extreme things or seeking comfort if we want to numb the feelings. And so, like you say, the breath, yeah, it's super important, isn't it? And you said something then about how difficult it can be to just come into even the breath, because we're so used to multitasking. So, you know, in my sessions, I say to people, I really encourage them. I say, please turn your phones off, turn off notifications on your laptop and devices. Never mind breakfast in half an hour after this session. Never mind what you're going to do later or what you did yesterday. Just see if for this moment you can focus simply on breathing. And you're absolutely right. It's actually an easy way in, because meditation can be so hard for so many people to just still the mind. The mind likes to be occupied. It really likes to know what's going on. And so when we just go, okay, I'm going to focus on just this experience of my breath, it's like a wave. And it's easy to just focus on either the sound or the feeling. And we all learn and experience differently, you know, but you've got the sound, the feeling, the embodied experience of breathing.
You shared a new nugget there, another golden nugget, is you said sometimes when we do the breathe, we don't allow ourselves to get there. I really want to pose on that and the importance of the trigger. And if something is blocking, you know, we can talk. So sometimes in breath work, you will have the body is going to contracting, you contract, you can go into different reaction of the body. And in one way, we can explain it, the physiology of it. You know, as you said, related to your diet, your minerals, and things like that. But be aware that your body doesn't want to go to places that is not familiar. And this is a safety mechanism, because as we are, you know, back in the days, if you go to something that is not familiar, you might die. And the body is pretty simple machine in that way, that it doesn't make a difference between the unfamiliar of, you know, an emotion that's coming back and the danger of death. So it's basically sending you the signal, hey, death danger, be careful, don't go there. So we're blocking it. Sometimes we're passing out. Sometimes we say we're falling asleep, or we are just decide that we are bored. So basically we're getting different signals sent to the brain, says, hey, don't go there. And it's interesting that between the heart and the brain, 80% of the communication is bottom up, heart to brain, neurologically. 20% is brain to heart. So we are constantly being told, hey, stay in your old pattern, stay in your trauma, because you actually know that's you, that has defined you now. Let's not go there. So it's very important to get a practice of embracing discomfort in one way or another, so that when triggers happen, when you are getting to unfamiliar spaces, you know what to do. You train yourself to be okay when you're not okay. And then when you are feeling these sensations, maybe I'm gonna go beyond it. Maybe I can continue the breath. Maybe I can trust that my body will be okay when it's not okay, when it feels that it's not okay. And let's, because that's when you go into the growth zone, you know, you serve the edge. And you will feel the sensation when you come on the other side. Oh my God, I have finally an incredible breakthrough. That's exactly what's going on. So it's important in any situation to assess, am I safe or am I in danger? Is it an old pattern that is coming back, or is it something that is really I'm jeopardizing my integrity? And you know, it can be in breathwork, it can be a partner who's saying something that triggers you, can be a parent, of course, but you know, it's just getting into the habit of, hey, whoa, what's going on there? What's going on? And why am I upset? Why do I want to check out from this situation? I'm not comfortable here. I want to leave and stop and shut up, sit down and breathe and feel it. And says, whoa, what am I feeling right now? Why is so? Because you've got now an incredible growth opportunity coming up. And then all of a sudden, staying with the breath, not getting away from it, allows you to have, you know, we all have traumas. We all have things that we are trying to let go of, that we're suppressing. Say, you know what, that's my past. Thank you. I don't need to talk about it. I don't need to revisit. Yeah, but don't worry. If you're not doing it, your body is keeping the memory of it. It's coming out in another way. And then you wonder why you have a cancer or you break your arm. You know, it is always coming out. So yes, witness what's going on in the body and just create the distance. And that's why I love the breath the most. You create that distance from the situation just by saying, okay, I'm going to choose to breathe now for 2-3 breaths and just let it sink. Let it, how does it feel? What's going on here? What am I witnessing in myself? And just that can be enough for getting an inch of what's going on. All right, so let's get technical a little bit. What's the difference between mouth breathing and nose breathing? Let's start with that. You know, and it's something that also is debated in the connected breath community. You've got people that will do an inhale through the nose, exhale through the mouth, and others will say no. It absolutely needs to be either nose, mouth, but you can't mix it both. So let's if you're familiar with it and if you want to dive right in, I think that could be interesting for a lot of breath workers out there. What do you think?
Well, you know, as many people as there are on this planet, there are as many opinions about how the world functions, how it works, how we work, what's best and what's not best. So I'm always a little cautious, but I kind of feel like in general, on a day-to-day basis, we want to be breathing in and out through the nose. So if we're walking around and we're moving, well, one, it calms the parasympathetic nervous system. It really activates that and really brings everything down. You just try it now. It's like...
So nose breathing parasympathetic, mouth breathing sympathetic. That's a very first basic information about the breath.
Yeah.
Yes.
And then also, because we are perfectly designed, the body is designed to filter what it needs, to take in what it needs. And we have these wonderful things in our nose, little hairs that filter out pollutants, that filter out the things that we don't really want to be breathing in. Would you want to, for example, walk through the center of Kathmandu with your mouth open, breathing in and out, taking deep breaths? No, I've been there. You wouldn't, because, you know, there are pollutants and things in the air everywhere. And so I feel like, you know, the only times I've really explored nose breathing just to retrain myself from any habits where my mouth might be inadvertently falling open, say during sleep, I practice mouth taping for quite a while. And this is where you use microporous tape over the mouth, and it retrains the body to deeply breathe in and out through the nose. And I found that my sleep quality improved dramatically. I wasn't waking up with sore throats or funky mouth, you know, where you've just been as you've been asleep. and the body does different things when we're breathing through the mouth. Now, I don't know enough about the science of nose breathing. Maybe you do.
I'll give you a few points. But for 5 years now, I put a tape on my mouth every night. So
this is
a non-negotiable. You know, it is something.
Not good for lovers, but great for health.
it's an incredible easy hack. So highly, highly recommend everybody just put a tape on your mouth, create, you know, some kind of a temple around your bed and create a healthy sleeping habits and nose. So nose breathing, it releases a gas called nitric oxide. And before I enter into the details, I really want to point people to Buteyko's work, Dr. Yeah. Buteyko, and Oxygen Advantage, which is a modern version of Buteyko, with tons Patrick of amazing, Patrick's work on amazing exercises around optimizing the delivery of oxygen to your organs. So in a nutshell, you breathe, when I breathe through my nose, I breathe more softly. It's a more softer delivery of oxygen, and I get rid of less CO2. So people are often obsessed with oxygen, but it's actually the CO2 that is the important factor. And I invite people to look up Bohr, B-O-H-R effect, if people who want to be technical. But in a nutshell, when I have a low CO2 level, it's not going to help the oxygen. It's going to reduce the quality of the oxygen delivery to the organs. When you have a high CO2 level, now all of a sudden you optimize the delivery of oxygen to your organs. So it's a very important practice. And you can buy an oximeter, so these little things you put on your finger, and just play with it and feel it. And it's pretty fun to play, you know, when you do a kumbhaka, when you start holding your breath, all of a sudden you can see the oxygen level dropping. It's quite striking.
I've got one of those. It is fun. I recommend it.
So check nitric oxide, NO, and all the benefits on nitric oxide is it helps vasodilatation. So, you know, that's what you have in Viagra. So this is one of the solution and one of the way to apply. You know, a lot of people have cardiovascular disease. So playing with it is also going to improve the circulation in your blood and quality of oxygenation of your blood, which is a huge issue. You know, what happens when you go to the hospital? They put you on the drip. What is in the drip? Liquid. Why? Because we're dehydrated. You know, that's the main problem people have, is they don't drink enough, and they don't drink waters that are beautiful water is not serving them. So, you know, you get a lot of oxygen through your water as well. So being mindful of what you drink, quality of your water that you drink, quality of the water you bathe in, to have beautiful water that is actually supporting your growth. And so really look into that. And they are referred to the work of Dr. Mark Cohen, who's done beautiful work on water. So yeah, that's that. So I 100% agree. You want to breathe through the nose. And if you want to use the mouth, you can kiss someone, you can eat, you can sing. But that's pretty much it. So that's rule of thumb. Use the nose for breathing, and the rest with the mouth. Now, then there is an intention around mouth breathing. I think that's the key difference, and that's where we can reconcile the both parties. Is now it's completely different in those breathing practices that you were talking about. Now all of a sudden, I set an intention. So what happens when we start breathing in a connected way through the mouth? Do you want to talk about that?
Are you asking me?
Yeah. I want to let you, you know, because I think you do that quite a lot in your approach.
I do. And what I see commonly happening, and I always start all of my sessions by framing it so that I give people back what we came to at the beginning of this, which is their sovereignty and their choice. So it's about finding the edges, so listening to the body, because when we start breathing through the mouth in a dynamic and active way, and we're really rapidly oxygenating the system, we're effectively consciously hyperventilating. We're bringing in that state of increased oxygen. The carbon dioxide doesn't have the chance to do what it normally does, which is rise up, level out again. So we're bringing in this rapid oxygenation, and people start to experience some physical symptoms that can be tingling around the mouth or cramping in the extremities. back to the beginning, can be influenced by diet, nutrition, and hormones and other things. But often just the act of breathing will create some of these symptoms for people. But it also puts us in that awareness. It's like a memory recall of the sympathetic fight flight response. And so it's kind of like, oh, something's happening here. I'm getting energized, I'm getting activated. And we start to label the feelings. I don't like that feeling. That reminds me of, and it's not always that conscious. It again can be coming from the body, but it's kind of basically we're bringing all of this activation into the system. And then as those feelings start to arise, or maybe the body's just doing what it did, as you so beautifully described it with your ice bath, where it's wanting to express itself. It's wanting to make a noise. It's wanting to cry, it's wanting to scream, it's wanting to move or pound or just actually flop and surrender. It's the learning to listen and trusting in the flow of that process as well. But I do find that the open mouth techniques, generally the reason that I do it and the reason that I love it is I see it as a form of soul retrieval. I see so many people accessing really hidden parts of their memory, their body memory, and their life experience just through breathing. So what I've seen in those plant medicine ceremonies will come simply through the act of open mouth breathing. Now, generally, in my experience, you don't get that when you're doing the more contained practices, which are what you want to be doing on a day-to-day wellness basis. But if you're working with it as a healing tool, because people will often say, they probably say it to you, can you do this too much? How often should I breathe? And I said, well, you're not going to be lying down on the floor like 2-3 times a day. Well, maybe some people are. You know, how often do you do that? I might do it once a week in somebody's session, or lie down, put my own playlists on and breathe to music. The rest of the time, I'm wanting to optimize things in the ways that you've described. So, yeah, it just brings about the open mouth breathing brings about, I feel, more of the kind of emotional processing, and brings that ability right up close for us to be able to be with that.
Yeah, beautifully said. And there, it's interesting to refer to the origin of this practice of holotropic breathwork, which was designed by a gentleman called Stan Grof, who really initially really worked with LSD and loved microdosing, and how through LSD and DMT you could access and relieve the past. You know, the problem with when you verbalize things in classic psychotherapy is you have to remember, and you get to remember things. And when you take substances, all of a sudden you are able to relieve the experience. And what happened is it got forbidden. He was not allowed to use it anymore. And then he figured out that through this breathing technique that you described of connected breath through the mouth, people were able to access similar state of altered consciousness. And actually, it's proper consciousness rather than altered consciousness. But you were all of a sudden getting to relieve crazy things like your birth. And there is some practices, and a lot of people love rebirthing, which is one side of breath work, and people love to do that too. You can go to relief, and I've witnessed it with someone who was with me. I actually saw him actually have complete rebirth, and that was very incredible. I never experienced that, but I witnessed it. And you are able, and I don't know, maybe, you know, it's, again, you know, you said you get to control hyperventilation. So I'm getting rid of a lot of CO2. And as we heard before, when you release a lot of CO2, now all of a sudden the oxygen is not delivered as well to the organs. So maybe, and I don't think there are many studies out there that are confirming that or the other, maybe you all of a sudden get less oxygen to the brain. And now the brain has to choose where to put the oxygen. And that, again, we are focusing. Now, again, we are selecting which part. And this unlocks all of a sudden, instead of having this noise, constant noise, and all these parts of the brain, the fear, the amygdala, the prefrontal cortex, and such activity going on in the brain. Now, all of a sudden, with this connected breath, I'm limiting the arrival of oxygen, and that gets me to a place where I can open the portal, where I can access some place where I didn't think was possible. And again, these are assumptions. I'm not sure there are really studies made that can support that, but that makes sense to me. And
is anybody dropping comments in, because maybe somebody who's watching might know, or and there might be
go ahead guys, ask questions. I have some people watching. I don't have comments yet, but don't hesitate to ask questions or comments, or you know, bring it
on. Please do.
It is meant for that. So yeah, we'll see. Maybe on your page, if you want to check on your page, maybe people are...
I'll have a look. I'm nervous because I don't want to...
You're more famous than me, so you have more followers. You know? I usually have my family following me, so that's...
Oh, bless. onto your page...
So that's really that idea that now, and that's why the big difference, and that's why we can reconcile both. Now I'm putting an intention to connect my breath because I want to go to a place that is not available to me all the time because I'm too busy. So, and that's the beauty of this connected breath practice. I love, and in my approach, I combine both. Exactly like you. I think we've come to the same approach. I do connected breath but I do it for 5-6 minutes. So here is my approach. I believe in daily habits. So I like to do a breathing technique that I can do every morning. I cannot go for a connected breath sessions. I do it sometimes, but it's a lot. Like I release, and when I'm done, I say, okay, thank you. Let's see you in 6 months. I have enough. But I wanted something that I could do every day, that gets me to center myself, to start the day connected to myself. But at the same time, I wanted to have a bit of clarity because there's so much noise going on that I wanted to recenter. And I found that I do 5 minutes connected breath, a retention empty lungs, a retention with a shoot. So that I use the work of Dr. Joe Dispenza, shoot on the inhale and sending spinal fluid all the way up to the pineal gland and the pituitary gland, and enjoying that, you know, allegedly release of DMT when you do the shoot. And then after that, I like to do coherent breathing. So, you know, 5 breaths per minute for 2-3 minutes. So that's my, and I do that 4 times. So that's about of a half an hour routine that I do every day. And I love it. I love that I live it. I have all the benefits of this practice, which is, you know, playing with my pH level. You feel high, you release adrenaline, endorphin, serotonin. I'm set for the day. It's incredible. You just upgrade yourself every morning. I mean, it's like warming up the car. You don't start 100 kilometers an hour. Yes.
And, well, tell me, Alex. So the practice that you've described, which I love, because you're giving people an opportunity to find a practice that they can do every single day in a short amount of time, and they could even cut that down and just even do one round and then be in awareness of the breath. How is that different, because you trained with Wim Hof as well, how is that different to the Wim Hof technique, which is a little similar to the Soma technique in my understanding?
Yeah, so
both of which are great, and they're
the different. The base is the Wim Hof method. The base of the structure is the Wim Hof method. But I say I put it on steroids. How? Because instead of doing 30 breaths, now I do 5, sometimes 7 minutes. So it's much longer. You could do probably 100 breaths. And I play with the rhythm. So sometimes I go faster, which Wim does as well. So we start with really the benefits of this connected breath. And if I find that sometimes people start releasing, I tell them to stay with the connected breath. I don't want them to interrupt the pattern. So I just feel in the group that is with me, and that's what I teach as well, to just feel what's alive and stay with what's alive, not necessarily stick to the plan. And then I do this retention empty lungs. But the Wim doesn't do a retention full lungs. He do just hold it for a few seconds, and then we move on. But I like to really do the squeeze. So I squeeze the abs, glutes, fist, lower back, even press the perineum and tongue at the roof of the mouth where the yin and the yang channel connect. So it's just some modifications, but it gets you to, and I really enjoy maybe 1 minute of bliss. And finally, I think this is the biggest difference. The fact that I take 2 minutes with either doing nothing, nose breathing relaxed, or coherent breathing, I feel that, and that's I owe that to Dr. Mark Cohen. It's almost like I feel euphoria because I experience dysphoria. You know, this is a lot of stress. And after that, I relax. So because I've experienced dysphoria, I get to experience euphoria. And that's hormonal release. So I always say, don't waste a good breath. And I feel that this sequence gets me to really harvest and harness the good breath. And I don't like the idea in the Wim. I love Wim. I mean, I owe him so much, yeah? But I don't like the fact that you jump to the next round right away. I like that you can take a break and feel, you know, in yoga, they say that the most important is not the pose, but it's the time between the poses, you know? And if you don't integrate after the breath and you just get up and go, you wasted it, you know? It's very important to integrate and feel. And I feel that getting that in every round gets me to really a place of center and ground. And you know, you cannot grow like a plant if you're not in the ground. You know, if you don't have the roots, you cannot grow. So for me, it's very important to really start the day grounded. Okay, I'm in my body. I'm embodied, and once I'm embodied, I can show up. But if I'm not embodied, I cannot show up. And I feel, you know, I'm alive when I share all that because I really want the world and I want kids to do this, to be embodied. Yes.
Well, let's speak to that, actually, because this is a real buzzword at the moment, embodied, embodiment. I use it, you use it, we've talked about presence. There may be people listening to this later on who go, what does that mean? You know, I am embodied, I've got a body, I'm walking around, I'm moving. But what does it mean to you? And what's the distinction that you're making there between, you know, when you wake up in the morning? I know what it is for me. It's coming in immediately, but I'm curious as to how you would interpret and explain that.
Sure. So basically, you cannot trust your brain. You have to let go of the fact that you can trust your brain. So whatever you think you don't think. It's your conditioning. It's your stories. It's your parents. It's your education. So we have to assume that you cannot trust the brain. The problem we have in the world is the same problem we have in our bodies. We have a top-down approach. Is my brain, what I believe, is running my life. My government is running my country, and my brain is running my life. But because I cannot trust my brain, I cannot trust my thoughts, they are not mine. It's conditioning, it's Facebook, whatever you want to call it. You can take all these avenues, it is the same. It doesn't work. So for me, embodied is changing the boss, changing the master, and allowing the breath and the heart, the soul, the body, you know, whatever is not the brain, to lead the way. So now every time I make a decision in my day, it comes from me. It doesn't come from my parents and all the stories that are going on there. So for me, that's what embodied means. It means I feel my body. I'm also listening to the body. I feel, oh, what is going on today? Oh, I feel tired. Okay, it's a slow day today. Or I feel strong. It's a good. So I allow the. And for men, it's not that easy. We don't have that those hormones that tell us the same information that you have. So it's not that easy. We operate a lot from the mind. So allowing this time to feel in the body what's going on today, and then that gives me the space to then honor myself, and be in integrity with myself today. Today, and I don't decide yesterday how I'm going to show up today. I don't know. I'm allowing these 15, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, if I can, to define, hey, all right, this is what we have to, this is what I have to play with today. All right, this is what feels right.
And that's where it ties in so beautifully with shamanism to me, because shamanism is called the way of the heart, the beauty way, the good red road, the path of the warrior heart. But it's all about coming into the absolute wisdom of the heart. And so many indigenous peoples from whom these lineages and teachings come will look at Westerners and just go like, oh my God, you know, one, we don't know how to sit still, be quiet and listen. Two, we have no idea how to tune into the body. We make our decisions from the mind and not from the feeling and the felt sense and the gut and the intuition and the heart's knowing. And, you know, these energy centers, these lower ones, you know, our gut sense, our hara, our center of balance, our center of will, our heart space, they're the ones that speak the truth. And so I love that you're saying, yeah, every day just come in. That for me, embodiment is present. For me, is presence to each moment. to my body within that moment, to my heart within that moment. And there, then, all of these feelings that arise that we go, oh, there's something happening here. Yes, they're going to be processed through the lens of my conditioning and my programming. And so I need to become mindful and gain some mastery of my thoughts. And, you know, when we were away, my teacher, Chris Luttikow of Northern Drum, who's absolutely fantastic shamanic teacher, highly recommended. But he was kind of, you know, the ego will always choose short-term comfort over long-term goals. So on the one hand, yes, there's some discipline required. It's a practice for me, shamanism, and the way that I live my life, which heavily includes the breath and breathwork awareness, is all about really learning to drop into that present moment and to develop self-mastery and self-awareness. And you could say, oh yeah, it could very easily tip. Self-mastery can become rigid. I see people doing that. I've got this meditation practice. I've got these practices. I'm working with the cold and I'm doing this, but they're doing it all the time. And I noticed that when we went through this recent weekend, all these robes of distortion that we wear, and one of them was, no, I'm not going to go into the teachings around this because I don't have the permission to teach it, but I'm mentioning it. One of them is called the workhorse, and it's about how people who get stuck in this pattern of working a lot, we talked about this briefly the other day, both of us love our work, so it never feels like work. But what I realized was that even for me, coming and sitting at my altar in the morning to do my practices, to breathe, to become mindful and to sit there, had become part of what I do. And I was like, shit, I've just lost connection to my practices because I'm doing it rather than being it or feeling it. It was such a great wake-up call. And so it's important to say to the people who are listening as well that any of these practices are there as, well, what are they there for, Alex? You know, why do you do what you do? Why do I do what I do? I know why I do what I do.
No, it is so important. You said it right. There is a bit of a diktat of mind over body. And I need to get in control. And there's a lot of those coaches that are really pushing that and saying that, yeah, you need to mind. Your mind is stronger than your body and you control it. You know, I get in the ice and I'm relaxing right away. So, but I think that, and that's why for me, this is an important element. Breathwork is just prep work. Half of what my teaching is around authentic relating. And what's happening once we are connected to ourselves, then we can connect with others. Then we can start to open up. Then all of a sudden the magic happens, the true healing happens, because not only you felt it, but you're able to express it and you do it in a collective manner. So all of a sudden there's a lot of magic happen. And really that idea of getting out of the way, you know, again, getting out of the way, it is really against what I, a lot of things that I read where, and they are not antinomic. They can all both is. Of course, you need routine and you need, but this is just to getting you out of the bad habits. It's important to not stay stuck with it, because it's, you can become a machine. You're not a robot. You're not a machine. You know, it's not, this is the craziness of the world we live in. You know, it's this Amazon world where, you know, you're transformed into a robot.
But I just want to backtrack a little, because I'm so glad that you brought in authentic relating. Because, you know, again, authentic relating, what is the prerequisite for authentic relating? It's a willingness to be vulnerable. We have to be, if we're going to be authentic. We have to be willing to be vulnerable. We have to be willing to speak our truth. And historically, when we've spoken our truth, because this tends to be what children do, we've been told off, we've been punished, we've been told that we're wrong, or you know, be quiet, don't make a fuss, da, 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 da. So we start evaluating that it's not safe to be authentic, it's not safe to be integral. And again, that's going back to that, you know, very animal thing that you mentioned just earlier, that's just kind of where we start to disconnect from our instinctive knowing and feelings. And so authentic relating for me is both the warrior, it's the vulnerable, the person who's willing to be vulnerable. And it's also about really owning, you know, not going into projection, not going into blame, not going into attack and judgment and all of those things, which doesn't mean that you don't have discernment. It doesn't mean that you don't have choice or that you can be selective and say, actually, that doesn't feel great for me, so I'm going to keep that on the outside of my circle. What am I going to bring into my circle that is really nourishing and healing and that makes me feel good, including thoughts, you know, especially thoughts. And so it's like, okay, I'm going to use these practices to actually bring myself to a place where I take full response ability. I am able to respond. And I don't need to make up a story, and I don't need to make you wrong. And that's the thing, coming back to the very beginning of this, that's the thing that bothers me in the implied criticism of all of these different techniques is, in order for me to be right, I need to make you wrong. The world hasn't functioned very well on that level of thinking. It's the essence of politics. Global politics and personal politics and community politics. COVID is showing us that. You know, it's kind of like, you're right, I'm wrong. It's teaching us more than anything how we sit in the place of not knowing and be with ourselves.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the authentic relating in a nutshell is how to get someone's world. And the idea of, I'm not going to come with a judgment that my vision of the world is superior to your vision of the world, but I'm coming from a place of curiosity because I want to understand, and I'm going to be asking questions so that I get to feel what it is to be you, what it is to be Steph, how is that in your world? And all of a sudden, we develop that empathy and we reconnect with others. And you mentioned something about childhood traumas. I refer people to the work of Gabor Maté, which is really absolutely fundamental. And it's basically saying that we all share the same trauma. Is as a child, you rely on your parents to survive. If they don't love you anymore, then they won't feed you, then you're going to die. So very early, you're told that it's more important to please my parents than to be authentic. Because speaking my truth, that only leads to trouble. So as you grow older, you want to fit into society, please your partner, get into a community, and you're gonna allow yourself to not be authentic, not speak your truth because you're afraid of the consequences. If I speak my truth, I'm gonna be rejected. And because of that childhood story, if I'm gonna be rejected by the group, I'm gonna die. I have to be, that's, you know, kids commit suicide every day around the world because they feel rejected. So it's very important to understand that trauma, because unless you resolve the original trauma, then you're not going to move on and realize that you can speak your truth. You can be whoever you want to be. You don't have to fit to the matrix. You don't have to become a lawyer or a doctor or whatever it is that the society needs from you. No, fuck everything. Fuck everyone. Be yourself. And when you know what happens when you are yourself? People love it. People are
jealous.
I've
always said that to my kids.
How can I, how do you do that? How are you yourself? Regardless of what that is, I don't need to have agree with who you are or find it that is in alignment with my values. I just appreciate that you have the ability to be yourself. Wow. And that's really, it's interesting because this is a shared trauma. So when we do authentic relating, it comes out and people get liberated from that. They can resolve that. And that's, for me, that's why I breathe. That is why I teach this and I get people to breathe. Because once we are able to resolve these childhood issues, then for me, this is the pathway to freedom. Then all of a sudden, we're able to live an authentic and be in integrity with ourselves. But we need to do that work. And you can't do it with a psychotherapist. It's too long. It's too hard. Breath is just an incredible shortcut.
I love the combination of being able to either have as a preliminary that maybe you've worked with psychotherapy or during or after or something comes up, or supervision or mentorship. There are always people who have walked the path and put in a lot of time and effort where when I know that there's something there that I can learn from their wisdom, that's respect. You know, that's where I see, okay, I really respect you. And there's something here that I can learn about, you know, kind of how to continue to grow and to develop. And I just feel like there's so many opportunities for us to combine multiple approaches to this complexity that we have of being human. I came away from the weekend and I was just like, oh my God, there's all this stuff about these stories that we make up and these robes and the ways that we distort things. And I'm going, you know, animals don't do this. They're just like, oh, I'm hungry, need to hunt. Oh, fancy some sex now, need to go and find somebody to have sex with. Oh, you know, need to lie down in the sun and chill for a bit here. They're so instinctive. And as human beings, yes, we've got the benefit of this wonderful big brain that we can use to evaluate and analyze. And that's amazing, because look at the things it's brought to the world. That's how you and I are talking, development, technology. But it can also become the monster that becomes the beast that isn't tamed and that dictates everything. And so coming back to that body, and again, I've been craving that so much lately, because the more things are taken away in terms of connection, contact, touch, instinct, I was just like, I was prowling at the weekend. I felt like a jaguar that was just like, oh, I need to just be in this body and move with the feelings. And every now and then I might be like, rah! Or then I might be, but it's just allow it to be felt and to move and to change and then use the practices. But the embodiment practices to me are everything.
100%.
And I can justify anything.
We are animals, guys. We are animals. Go back to your animal self. That's why I love the ice bath. That's why I walk barefoot and I get in the cold. You know, I go get my, I'm in Paris and I go barefoot in t-shirt and shorts and it's 4 degrees and everybody thinks I'm crazy. I think everyone else is crazy. Yeah, I'm in my body. I can feel my feet and I can feel everything being alive. And it is so important to have some kind of ways to reconnect to nature, to your true nature, in one form or another. But yeah, I, as expected, we didn't go where we wanted, but we went where we needed to go. So Steph, thank you so much.
We did cover quite a bit of it. I feel that we covered quite a bit of it, but yeah, there's just always more, isn't there? So thank you for inviting me on. And, you know, I look forward to sharing this. I'm hoping that I can share it via my YouTube, send me the recording and just, you know, any opportunity, Alex, your big generous heart and your passion for what you do is really palpable, you know, and I love it. So
same for you. And I love your wisdom and I love definitely the feminine approach that you have, you know, and I think that's why we get along, and that's a good balance.
I was really feeling that masculine feminine thing earlier. I was like, whoa, okay, that's interesting.
yeah, but as a conversation, that's really interesting. And yeah, guys, you know, it's open for debate, and that's I guess that's my intention, is to just connect with more people and get the conversation flowing. So, you know, how do you feel about this conversation? Anything that came up for you, anything that got triggered, go ahead. You know, this is a safe space. If you feel like it, please be caring of everyone's opinion and let it out and express it, so we can, you know, have a really nice discussion following. Yeah. That's what we need these days. All right, guys. So thank you, Steph. What's next for you? So what's... call to action. What are you having?
Call to action.
Right now?
Well, as you know, our next facilitator training starts in a week's time. Well, just over a week's time, about 10 days. Super excited. We're taking applications for our May training, 7 months online. I'm bringing you in as a guest. I've spoken to my colleague. I'm really excited about that. I love having people bring their particular passions in. So the one after is in March 2021, and I've got a brief 7-week course, which is working around the shamanic medicine wheel and our relationship to each direction. So we look at what's our relationship like with thoughts and the critical mind in the north. What's our relationship like with our passion, our dreams and our vision in the east? What's our relationship like with our ability to be vulnerable, to be childlike, our emotional well-being in the south? In the west, we have our relationship to the physical body. So all this kind of yummy stuff that we've been talking about. And we move all the way around the wheel ending with ourselves in the center. That's beautiful. That starts in January and it's super affordable. So I welcome anybody. How about you?
January, I don't do workshops anymore. I only do teacher trainings and I'm loving it. We have an incredible tribe. They're supporting each other. They're all teaching in one form or another. And I'm loving it how they went to the next level of themselves. And, you know, you can see on my Instagram, you'll see amazing testimonials coming over. It's really, I'm very blessed and humbled by the deep transformation that happened on these humans. And I always say, I teach what I need to learn. And that's why I do teacher trainings, because most of the people join, they don't want to teach. They just want some kind of change in their life. And they realize after that, oh my God, this is so powerful. Breathwork, authentic relating, all these things are so powerful that they want to bring it to their friends, to their families. And for me, this is an incredible satisfaction. So 4th of January, it's online. It's 6 weeks. I'm very, very proud of it. I bring incredible humans. And we approach the breath from incredible free divers, and then osteopaths and doctors and people that do really massages and that get to really, how do you meet the pain and through massages really feel what's going on in the body and release tensions and really stored negative emotions. It's a beautiful journey. So send me a private message or check out all the details in my bio. There's plenty of it. And I highly recommend Steph's work as well. She's an incredible facilitator. Absolutely love her sessions. So guys, you can't go wrong. There's some great breath workers out there. And I'm very grateful for this live, very grateful for all of you, and grateful for you, Steph. All right, guys. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you for joining us.
Yes, bye-bye. And.